Is the sky the limit? Yes, the sky is indeed the limit. But only for those who are afraid to fly. Ever since man looked up into the night sky, the fascination for man to know more about the world beyond and what lies outside our frontiers had kicked off. When every organism on this beautiful planet had been searching for food, water, and territory on Earth, one organism named human was searching the same food, water, and territory. Not on Earth, but on other planets. If man was not created to explore, he would have had roots, not feet. And now, his latest plan is to colonize their closest neighbor, the moon. And now, we will be seeing what would happen if we are one of the people in the moon. Not as one of the early settlers, but as one of its citizens. First of all, how can we construct cities on the moon? In 2005, sparked an idea named the Shackleton Dome that had electrified the aerospace industry. It is an ellipsoid of horizontal radius of 20 kilometers and a height of around 1,500 meters. And that is more than 16 Statues of Liberties stacked one on top of the other. This dome will be covering a crater on the surface of the moon, namely the Shackleton Crater. And this dome would host a megapolis where we could witness the transition of a small patch of dry lunar dust into huge and prospective urban complexes with modern infrastructure offering eye-opening experiences and panoramic views that would outstrip our wildest imaginations about the future. But, why is it only a dome and not any other structure? That's because domes offer exceptional tensile strength when compared to other shapes and are therefore the strongest 3D shapes mankind has ever known. Therefore, this dome can handle much higher pressure, force, impact from craters, and other hazards that occur on the surface of the moon. But, how practical is this approach? Well, we have to use heavy-duty materials that can withstand the temperatures, pressure and other physical phenomena of the moon. But how will these structures be made? For this, we have taken inspiration from our own Mother Nature. Just like how we took inspiration from birds to design aeroplanes, ventilation systems inspired by termite mounds, bullet train shapes inspired by kingfisher beaks, climbing feet inspired by lizards to name a few. Similarly, for this dome, we are taking inspiration from the structure of a beehive. This honeycomb structure of hexagonal prismatic cells is ideal to serve the purpose. And the materials we will be using to make this are titanium to make the skeleton. That is the outline for the grid of the honeycomb, and we will be using basalt fibers or even tempered glass as a cheaper alternative to fill the outline of the honeycomb structure. And this huge structure would be anchored to bedrock. But, this would require 16 trillion kilograms of silica. There are estimated to be almost 3.6 septillion kilograms of silicon in the Earth's crust. That is 36 followed by 23 zeros. Which means there is enough silica on the Earth to make 225 billion Shackleton domes. But unfortunately, this silica is not always found in its pure form. Silica is a constituent of more than 95% of the rocks, and therefore extracting silica from the rocks is like squeezing water from stone. And apart from that, the city would be sparkling radiant just like how cities would be in the future. Not because of technological advancements, but because the construction of buildings on the moon would be made up of materials found on the surface of the moon. And one of the major minerals found on the moon in overflowing quantities is one of the members of the feldspar mineral series named anorthite. And its symbol is CaAl2Si2O8. And as we can see, the two essential elements required to make glass, namely aluminum and silicon, can be found in anorthite. And another important building material that would be used in this city is a concrete-like geopolymer that could be made from two more procurable stuff. One of them is moon dust and the other is human urine. But, we need not worry, as the foul smell of the urine would perish. But, apart from materials, there are other snags. One is the mismatching system of day and night. One lunar day equals 29 Earth days. This means that on the moon there will be 29 days of light and 29 days of darkness. But, the duration of darkness narrows down to 4 days if we live at the poles. And we have to adapt ourselves to that and also the moon's gravity. Next is the food pattern. Crops and fruits could be cultivated in vertical gardens. But, we won't be able to consume meat and animal products. Anyways, meat can come frozen from the earth once in a while. And this mega project would cost almost $10 billion, along with $2 billion increasing every year as per the ongoing costs. But, what do we get in return for spending this mammoth price tag? The moon contains immense reserves of an isotope of helium named helium-3. But, what can helium-3 do? As our natural resources are getting scarce by each passing day, helium-3 would be a pollution-free alternative as it can be used in fusion reactors. You can see the Herculean price of just 1 gram of helium-3. Therefore, this helium-3 mining can make up the cost for initial construction and for mining. And just 1 kilogram of helium-3 can power the entire South Africa for a whole day, and also can power more than 75 of the least populated countries in the world for an entire day. And this isotope is rare on Earth, but is available in plenty on the Moon. But, this mining has its own hazards as well. This export and moon tourism would bring a lot of wealth to moon cities. And the ownership of these metropolises would not be claimed by any nation in the world. After seeing such technological advancements in the last decade, 4 lakh kilometers does not seem so far away. And colonizing the moon could bring us answers to our questions. But, would also add a few more questions to the future generation. And thus the quest of asking questions and finding answers for them is never ending.